Honorable Member for Edmonton Strathcona.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I would like to say that it's a great pleasure to stand and speak to this motion, but frankly, I find it really sad that the Honourable Member from Halifax has to again bring this matter before the House because nothing is happening. Mr. Speaker, over the last year, the religious leaders of this country have been meeting on Parliament Hill because they are so frustrated at the lack of action by this government on what they see as a matter of great impact to the planet. Marty Tindall, the moderator of Canada's largest Protestant denomination, the United Church, has called on us to consider climate change a crisis of conscience. She has urged Canadians to choose hope and action over despair and paralysis in addressing what she calls one of the most urgent moral challenges in human history. This government has, only at the 11th hour, after being in power for 6 years, revealed that it intends to pull out of Kyoto. They could have revealed that 6 years ago and been honest. But instead, they've helped this country out for potential penalties because of their complete inaction. Absolutely reprehensible. They have failed to deliver even on their own commitments to reduce greenhouse gases. They have failed to deliver on the commitments that they, as the Government of Canada, made at the Conference of the Parties, in Bali, in Copenhagen, and in Cancun. What have some of those commitments been? Well, in Copenhagen, they actually committed to reduction of greenhouse gases. And what have they done instead? Nothing, and allowed our emissions to rise continuously. At Cancun, they committed, and I know this because I was in the room when they signed and sealed on this. They committed that they would issue a national low-carbon energy strategy. Well, Mr. Speaker, where is that low-carbon energy strategy? So we have a government who likes to accuse previous governments, the Liberals they like to pick on, who didn't take a lot of action either. They have been in power for 6 years and have gone to many international conferences on this important matter and delivered nothing on their commitments. Now we're hearing that they are appearing at the conference and shamefully suggesting that they may not even provide the funding to lesser developed countries that are suffering the impacts already of climate change. The Commissioner for Sustainable Development, who works in the Office of the Auditor General, has done a series of auditor reports. The Auditor General issued a report just this year castigating this government for the absolute failure to deliver on its promised reductions. Instead of requiring reduction in greenhouse gas emissions, they have significantly lowered their targets by 90%. Apparently, according to the Commissioner for Sustainable Development, who did an audit, between the years 2007-2010, Canadian emissions rose by 31% above the 2006 committed targets. He reported there was inconsistent reporting on climate measures and no clear measurable way to measure their programs, despite allocating over $9.2 billion. Well, where did that $9.2 billion go? We'll get to that in a moment. The Commissioner also said that there was a stop-and-start pattern, and it sends an inconsistent message to industry, to other levels of government, and to Canadians. And even the industry, even the fossil fuel industry, we have noticed over the last year, are fed up and expressing concern that there is no legal certainty and that in order to move forward in their sector, they need clear legal binding targets. Well, the government then accused the Commissioner for Sustainable Development for not being up to date. And so its own department issued a report. And that report found even more problems, that it was missing meeting even its own meager targets. This government ran on a platform, Mr. Speaker, of openness and transparency. Whatever happened to that party? These government members, every one of them, voted against the New Democrat bill, which was tabled twice in this House, passed twice in this House, for simply calling for accountability on actions on climate change. And it wasn't enough that they couldn't win because the majority of elected officials were in favor of this bill. They called upon the Senate to kill that bill. And so we now have before us absolutely no real binding measure to control greenhouse gases. And to make matters worse, they have been very clear that they are opposing any binding treaty out of the meetings that are going now in the conference of the parties. Why not just be honest? Why don't they just tell us? They don't agree to have any binding treaty. They've lobbied against every binding treaty that has been proposed in the last 6 years of the conference of the parties. So where are we at now? Well, if we turn to organizations like the International Energy Agency, to which Canada belongs, and it's consisted of the major fossil fuel industries of the world, well, what does the International Energy Agency say? Every further delay comes with costs. They warn that any delay in coming to a global agreement will lead to significant lock-in of carbon-intensive infrastructure. Every year of delay of introduction of a global framework with the sufficiently powerful economic incentives to direct investment to follow the path of the 2% scenario has two consequences. It increases the capital stock that will be needed to be retired early, mostly in the power and industry sectors, and limits dramatically the amount of more carbon-intensive infrastructure that can be added in the future. They say that delaying action to 2015 will increase the cost of action by $4.3 for every dollar saved. This is supposedly the party that believes in a strong economy. Doesn't sound like it. We need simply look to Alberta, where because of this government, who intentionally have issued regulations for the coal-fired sector, which will exempt coal-fired power plants that have not even started being built. So no action on the single largest source of greenhouse gases being emitted in Canada right now, and no regulations at all for the oil sands sector. And so in the meantime, Albertans, Alberta taxpayers, are being called upon to pay the costs of massive transmission lines from our expanding coal-fired sector to the United States. How's that for a good economic plan? The majority of Canadian greenhouse gases, as reported by Environment Canada, are in the energy sector, 82%. Transport, 28%. In the last decade, fossil fuels have represented 54% of the growth in greenhouse gases and transport, 45%. The key issue is cost. The Canadian economy, it's been put forward that the National Roundtable, who is appointed by this government and reports to this government, they are reporting that the imminent costs to Canada for climate warming and the order of $20 to $40 billion a year by 2050. That's 5 to 25% of the GDP. And this is the government that claims that they're fiscally responsible. The sad thing, Mr. Speaker, is there are a myriad solutions and solutions that will save money for Canadians. The technologies already exist. We've heard it in committee after committee that we've got university researchers, we've got technology being tested in the field. But absent the regulatory triggers, nobody is going to invest. We need action, but we're waiting for federal leadership. Mr. Speaker, we're waiting for federal leadership on revising the National Building Code. The government of Alberta has been very clear that they will not upgrade their building code until the federal government upgrades its building code to ensure that we have more energy-efficient buildings required. We're waiting for leadership in energy retrofits. After a massive campaign by Canadians, they finally relented to return the program for 1 year. And yet we had a burgeoning energy efficiency sector, including in my riding, a lot of young people wanting to get into this sector, who have essentially given up on this area of work. Where is the leadership on training? Incredible opportunities for our youth, for our Aboriginal communities, for our immigrants to be trained in the new energy economy. Where is the leadership? Where is the leadership on the smart grid? This government lauded the agreement that they signed, the US-Canada energy dialogue. Where is the leadership? Where is the smart grid? Renewables? They yanked all the money from renewables. And meanwhile, around the world,
other countries are profiting, and soon we will have to buy their technologies. Where is the level playing field? Billions to merely test carbon capture sequestration for the coal industry and the oil sands, a mere millions for the renewable sector. Are you telling me, Mr. Speaker, my time is pretty well up? Okay, I will speak of other matters during questions. Thank you.
Questions and comments? Question and comment.
Questions and comments. The Honourable Member for Abbotabek-Témiscamingue. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As my colleague from Alberta just said, I would imagine that she's concerned about the economy in her province. And I'd like to know whether or not, in her opinion, there is any way to exploit the oil sands in an ecological and responsible fashion.
Strathcona.
I'd like to thank the Honourable Member for her question. It's a very good question, and the answer is absolutely yes. I participated in committee hearings over a two-year period and issued my own report. Why was that important? Because we heard testimony from a lot of parties, including major researchers in this country. I also attended an oil sands fair, and I went around to all of these new technologies, and I said, what's the big barrier, key barrier, to you not selling your technologies? And they said, the lack of regulation. The government is not requiring anybody to clean up this sector, and therefore nobody is investing in my cleaner technologies. The technologies are there. We need to get them out of the lab and into the field. What's missing? Federal regulation.
Questions and comments? The Honourable Minister of State for Western Economic Diversification.
Yes, I would like to know if the members, if she can acknowledge our investments in the Clean Energy Fund, the Eco Energy Technology Institute, the carbon capture storage projects that are helping Canada position itself as producer of reliable clean electricity for the decades to come. I wanted to know if she recognizes $1.5 billion in investments that that will be over the next 10 years. I want to know if she acknowledges the Eco-Energy Retrofit Homes Program that is helping Canadians make energy-efficient homes, the $148.8 million over the next 5 years to help the country adapt to climate change. I want to know if she's ever visited the oil sands and actually saw the work that has been done with technology helping the oil sands through all of their initiatives. Has she visited there to see the work that they have done?
The Honourable Member for Edmonton Strathcona.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I don't have time to answer that question. I'd like to give an elaborated answer. Of course, I've been to the oil sands. I've been working for 40 years and trying to clean up that sector. I recommend that the Honourable Member go to my website and read the report that I've issued, wherein are listed by the recommendations by the Deputy Premier, Northwest Territories, First Nation leaders, scientists, calling for the government to issue clear regulations and standards so that, in fact, we control that sector. One thing that I would point out to the Honourable Member, the hypocrisy of this government. Well, this government says that it won't take any action and won't majorly require reduction of greenhouse gases in this country because China's not acting. This is the very government that is encouraging the shipping of raw bitumen to China so that they will be upgrading, refining, and increasing their greenhouse gases. So I don't need to take any lectures from that side of the House about what's needed to actually address greenhouse gases. We need to work together with other countries, but first and foremost, we need to act here. And I think if they pass the regulations, then the taxpayers of Canada won't have to bear the burden that is going to be placed on them and next generations.
Questions and comments? Question and commentaire? L'honorable député.
The Honourable Member for Drummond. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to congratulate my colleague on her great speech. And I would just like to remind her of some data and ask her whether she thinks we should absolutely not disassociate the economy from the environment and that the two things go hand in hand.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Excellent question. That, of course, is the policy that this party stands by. That's the policy that the other side pretends they stand by, but put absolutely no heart in the environment side of that agenda. There is no reason why we can't have a strong Canadian economy and also a clean environment. And there has been proposal by proposal put forward. The technologies are there. There have been two evaluations, give you some concrete examples, two evaluations of how we could green electricity. This government promised that they would provide 90% clean electricity, I think, by 2020, and have done nothing in that direction except go the opposite way. Two reports by Pembina Institute of Ontario and Alberta have shown by 2020 we can have completely clean electricity without reverting to nuclear. So there are the technologies are there, we just don't have the regulatory drivers because this government doesn't believe in that.
Resuming debate, the Honourable Member.